Detective Martin Brunning has a vicious murder case on his hands and a prime suspect at large. The hunt is on to find her.
I was content at that point that Joanne Dennehy was a suspect in the murder of Kevin Lee, and all the energy over that weekend was to get our hands on her as quickly as possible. There's a heavily bloodstained mattress in a house in Byfield where Joanne lived. And I'm thinking, is this where Kevin was killed? But I'm also being told that one of the tenants is missing. A guy called John Chapman, who was vulnerable, should have been there, wasn't. This man who I'm told leads this simple lifestyle of drinking and sleeping and never venturing too far from the house, he's not there. Where is he? So is it a missing guy, or is it something terrible's happened to him? And I'm thinking, if it's something terrible's happened to him, and we've actually got two murders, then how much of a risk is she to the public that she's not going to stop?
Acutely aware of the public risk, Detective Brunning widens the net.
I put her picture in the media over that weekend. We know she's distinctive. She's got this tattoo on her face. And I'm thinking, we're going to get a line of inquiry from this. We're going to get a breakthrough. Somebody's going to say, I've just seen Joanne Dennehy. I've seen why you want her. And I'm thinking, we're going to get control around this really, really quickly.
A minor theft 80 miles away had given a clue to Joanne's possible whereabouts.
A detective in Norfolk, he was investigating a shoplifting where a car had driven onto the forecourt of a petrol station just outside of Cromer and had recognised the similarity of a female who got out the passenger seat, went into the store, stole a whole load of groceries and food, and then got back in the car. And that was the absolute breakthrough in order to start to track Joanne and Gary. We were able to start really honing down where that vehicle was. We recognised that it was a green Vauxhall Astra, that it had been activating AMPR all around the east of England. And in fact, at one stage, we were getting live time notifications that the car was travelling on the M5 southwest towards the West Mercia police area.
A local murder hunt has now become a three-county investigation.
We were straight on the phone to West Mercia saying, look, this car has got these people in it. They've certainly killed one person in Cambridgeshire. You need to get your hands on them and please ring me when you've done it. And it was as fast moving as that. It was exhilarating. It was pressured. It was, we're nearing the end. We're going to get our hands on these people and then we can put our foot on the ball and take stock of exactly what's gone on.
As sightings come in, Martin's team is able to piece together an audacious picture of Joanne and Gary's movements over the bank holiday weekend.
The evidence shows Dennehy and Stretch walking into the services on the M5 hand in hand without a care in the world. They were breaking into people's houses, stealing food, stealing cameras to turn into cash whilst on the run. They were taking pictures of themselves in towns throughout the east of England. It was an elaborate cops and robbers event that they added and weaved into an element of fun, that it was thrilling, it was exciting, they were untouchable, and this romantic relationship that was blossoming whilst on the run from the police has so many parallels to Bonnie and Clyde that it's almost beyond belief. Eventually that phone call comes, but it comes with the caveat that there's been a whole load of carnage in Hereford.
Involved in that carnage, two people matching Joanne and Gary's descriptions.
The information that we were getting was that Gary and Joanne were together in Hereford in the car, and Joanne had attacked two strangers, two men, horrendously with the knife within a 10-minute time frame, which realised every fear that I had about just what she was capable of doing.
Those two men were 64-year-old Robin Baretza, attacked while walking his dog, as was 56-year-old John Rogers.
She was stabbing in my chest. She said, look, you're bleeding. I'd better do some more. And I think I said, just leave me alone, please. please leave me alone. And then when it did finally stop, I just thought, well, this is it. I'm going to die.
When Joanne is arrested, she shows little of the bloodlust that's fueled her brutal attacks.
Joanne was caught in the vehicle which had parked up after the second stabbing. She was a passenger in the front seat. She was very calm. She engaged with the officers and even produced the knife that she had just used on the two men in Hereford and handed it over to the officers.
Joanne is brought to Hereford Police Station for booking.
Afternoon.
Afternoon. Joanne Christina Dennehy.
You've been arrested on suspicion of attempted murder and murder. Okay.
Joanne presented at the custody desk as if she was in a really euphoric state. And the video that I saw subsequently showed her in a really relaxed frame of mind.
Would you be cheery if you were up for attempted murder and murder?
I wouldn't, but...
No, but I was smiling.
I don't know anything about it.
Yeah.
I was just out enjoying the sunshine.
You're winning about Nippers, shortly. Say again.
I look forward to it.
You're a decent copper. I'm cracking on.
Yes, I'm going to be caught, so.
Yes, please.
Oh, come on, enjoy.
Can I have some food first?
I'll take your order when you get in the cell. What do you want to drink?
Amongst the jokes, Joanne makes a chilling revelation.
She told the custody officer at the time, in a kind of prancing around the custody room style, that she'd killed five people. Did she mean, in her calculation, that the five people that she killed included John Rogers and Robin Beretta? Have we got more murders? How does this kind of progress? How does it unfold? We've got the complexity of a murder in Cambridgeshire. We've got two people that sound like they're going to die in Hereford. And actually, it's a really pressurised time. Really pressured. On Wednesday, I came into work to start to join the investigation in West Mercia with Cambridgeshire. And as I was briefing the team, the phone on the desk next to me rang, and I picked it up, and it was the force control room saying, we've had a report that a body has been found in a ditch in Thorny Dyke. And instinctively, I thought, that's going to be John Chapman. We hadn't explained his absence. He was so close to Dennehy in lifestyle terms, living in the same house. This is going to be John Chapman. Before I'd had a chance to do anything or make any decision, the phone rang again. I'll never forget this phone call for as long as I live. It said, are you aware of the body that has been found in Thorny Dyke? And I said, yes, I've just been briefed. And the woman in the control room said to me, there's two bodies. And it stunned me. And I held the phone to my chest and just said, there's two bodies. And you could hear a pin drop. And I had this, but the only way I could describe it is a rush of adrenaline, of what is going on? What's happening? When's this gonna stop? However bad it has been, up to this point with Kevin, Robin Beretta, John Rogers, however bad that has been for those people and those families, this has just got a whole lot worse. That phone call absolutely changed the game. And I realised that if this was the work of Joanne Dennehy, we're dealing with a serial killer.